fellas, if you haven't signed up for the men's retreat yet, we would encourage you to do that right away. We're going to have a great time out there at Murrieta together, worshiping the Lord and studying the Word. It's going to be a wonderful experience. You won't want to miss it. Shall we turn now in our Bibles to Acts chapter 20, beginning tonight with verse 29. Paul is talking to the elders of the church of Ephesus. He's on his way back to Jerusalem. He knows that there are problems that await him, an uncertain future. He doesn't really know whether or not he is going to survive physically. And he does believe that this is probably the last time he'll be seeing these men. They've worked together for 3 years. Close bonds are made as you work together in the cause of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so it's sort of a difficult kind of farewell to them. And there will be tears coming along next week as we continuing this study. But the thing that troubles Paul is that he knows the pattern of false teachers. He knows that as soon as he leaves, that there are these predatory wolves that are ready to move in and to prey upon the Church of Jesus Christ. Jesus warned his disciples about false prophets. He said they would actually look like sheep, but inside they were ravening wolves. One of the great banes of the church has been the false prophets who prey upon the unsuspecting saints. They are wolves, and they look at the church, the lambs, as something to be devoured. False and lying prophets are inspired by Satan, and they've existed from the beginning. It began with Satan's lies to Eve in the garden, the false prophecies, the challenge of the Word of God, and then the spreading of his lies. Surely you will not die. God doesn't want you to eat of that because he knows that when you do, you will be wise as God. And so that was a false prophecy to Eve, and she succumbed to it. And as a result, the death that entered the world and we are all suffering as the consequence of Eve listening to Satan and Adam following along in the sin. The false prophets do not wear signs saying, "I am a false prophet," nor do they actually look like false prophets. It isn't a case of, "Grandma, what big eyes you have." They don't look like wolves. They look very innocent. Have you noticed oftentimes when a person is guilty of some horrendous crime and they are arrested and you look at the man, you would think, "I would never pick him out," you know. You usually pick out some wild-eyed kind of a person. You say, "Yeah, I can see where he would do it." But so often, they don't look like the type that would commit such an atrocity. Paul said in Corinthians, "For such are false apostles, they are deceitful workers, as they transform themselves into the apostles of Christ. And no marvel," he said, "because Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light, and therefore it's no big deal if his ministers also are transformed as the ministers of righteousness, Paul said, whose end shall be according to their works. Satan's goal is to destroy you. He is no friend. And if you give yourself over to his lies, you're on a path of destruction. How can you tell a false prophet? Well, as we mentioned, you can't tell him by his looks, because he looks like a sheep, according to Jesus. You cannot always tell them by their words, for the scripture speaks about they're using feigned words. The Greek word is plastos, from which we get our word plastic. And you've heard a person with a plastic smile. You know that it's a fake smile. You might say that that fruit in the bowl is not real fruit. It's made of plastic. That is, it's been molded to look like fruit, but it really isn't fruit. And that's what he is using for the word feigned words. They sound good, but they're not true. They're not real. There's a lack of real quality to them. Peter tells us how that we can recognize a false prophet. He said, they seek to make merchandise of you. Bottom line, they're going to try to get their hand in your wallet or in your pocketbook. Peter said that in chapter 2, verse 1, but there were false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false prophets among you, who privately shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that bought them. And they will bring upon themselves swift destruction, but many shall follow their pernicious ways, and they shall speak evil of the way of truth. And they will allure many to follow them, and they will make up false stories to make merchandise of you. Let me interject at this point that anyone who hints or suggests that by your giving to their enterprise that a loved one can be saved or healed, or that you can miraculously have money come back to you 60, 100-fold, are the kind of false prophets that Peter is warning against. Peter said their judgment is long overdue, but their damnation shall rise. For if God spared not the angels that sinned, but he cast them down to hell, he delivered them into the chains of darkness to be reserved unto the judgment. And he spared not the old world, but he saved Noah, the eighth person, a preacher of righteousness, as he brought the flood upon the world of the ungodly. And turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into ashes, he condemned them with an overthrow, making them an example to those that will live ungodly. And he delivered just Lot, who was vexed with the filthy lifestyles of the wicked around him. For that righteous man who was dwelling among them, as he saw and heard their ungodly activities, his righteous soul was vexed day after day. The ungodly activities, or the Lord knows how to deliver the godly out of temptations and to reserve the unjust for the day of judgment to be punished. But chiefly those that walk after the flesh in the lust of uncleanness and despise government. They are presumptuous. They are self-willed. They're not afraid to speak evil of dignities, whereas angels, which are greater in power and might, do not bring railing accusations against them before the Lord. But these, as natural brute beasts, made to be taken and destroyed, speak evil of the things that they do not understand. They shall utterly perish in their own corruption. They will receive the reward of unrighteousness, for they count it pleasure to riot in the daytime. They are spots and blemishes as they sport themselves in their own deceitful ways while they feast with you. Their eyes are full of adultery. They cannot cease from sin. They beguile unstable souls, and they have filled their hearts with covetous practices. They are cursed children who have forsaken the right way. They've gone astray. They followed the way of Balaam, who loved the wages of unrighteousness, even though he was rebuked for his iniquity. The donkey, speaking with a man's voice, forbade the madness of the prophet. These are wells without water. They're clouds that are carried with the tempest, to whom the midst of darkness is reserved forever. For they speak great swelling words of vanity, and they arouse the lust of the flesh through wantonness, those that had escaped from them who live in error. While they promise liberty, they themselves are servants of corruption. For of whom a man is overcome, of the same is he brought in bondage. For if after they have escaped the pollutions of the world through the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they are again entangled therein and overcome, the latter end is worse with them than the beginning. For it had been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than after they have known it to turn from the holy commandment that was delivered unto them. But it has happened unto them according to the true proverb, the dog has returned to his own vomit, and the pig that was washed to her wallowing in the mire. In verse 33, Paul, speaking of himself, said, I have coveted no man's silver or gold or apparel. False prophets, they will seek to make merchandise of you. Paul said, I haven't coveted your silver, your gold, your apparel, as you yourselves know. With my own hands, I've ministered unto my necessities and to them that were with me. And I've shown you all the things, how that in so laboring, you ought to support the weak and to remember the words of our Lord Jesus, how he said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. When Paul wrote to the Philippians, he said, brethren, be followers together of me, and mark how the false prophets walk, so that you have us as an example. For many walk, of whom I have told you often, and I now tell you even weeping, that they are enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly. They glory in things which they should be ashamed of, and their mind is on earthly things. That is, they live in million-dollar homes, they are complete with wine cellars, they fly around the country in their own personal jets, they ride in chauffeur-driven limos, and they tell you precious little partners how desperately God needs your money. Paul realizes that there are always those who will take advantage and will fleece the flock of God. Paul was the one that God used to establish the church there in Ephesus. As far as he knows, this will be the last time he will see these elders. They are to take over the responsibilities of ministering to the flock, feeding the flock of God. But Paul realizes that as soon as he is gone, there's going to be a power struggle. When God has built a powerful and successful work, it always attracts those who are hungry for power and who would like to control the assets that have been garnered. There will be those from outside, Paul said, who will come and they will try to lure people after themselves. But also, there will be wolves from within who will try to take over and control the work of God. Those within your own body, Paul said, who will become involved in this power struggle as they try to draw people after themselves. There have been ministers who have started churches in this area in the hopes of siphoning off a part of the congregation here as soon as I die. They've actually declared that I can't live much longer, and so we'll get a church started here, and as soon as Pastor Smith dies, then, people will probably start looking around for other churches, and so I'll be here waiting with open arms to receive them. I've had a couple of fellas that have made that statement, but I'm going to fool them. I'm going to live until the Lord comes again, so. So having said that to these elders, Paul then tells them to watch. Watch out. Be on guard. He said, remember that for 3 years, I did not stop warning everyone both night and day with tears. As Paul wrote to the Philippians, he said that he was weeping as he wrote to them because of the work of the false prophets. Now, as he talks to the Ephesian elders, again, he speaks of how deeply he was moved emotionally. It really got to Paul that people could be deceived by these false prophets. Paul loved them as a father. And he knew that there were others that would come in and they would feign love. They would say all kinds of complimentary types of things to the people to win the people after themselves, not with a true love, but in their hearts, their desire was to just feed off the flock of God rather than to feed the flock of God. So this was a heavy burden on the heart of Paul. It brought him to tears. It seemed like with Paul's ministry, there were those that would follow Paul around. Now, Paul was a trailblazer. He would go out into the world that knew nothing of Christ. He would bring the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ to them. He would establish works. People would be saved. People would start meeting together and serving the Lord together. But no sooner would Paul leave an area than these false prophets would move in after him. And they would begin to subtly put Paul down. Well, you know, he's not a true apostle. He is sort of a self-appointed apostle. And he's really in disagreement with a lot of the things that the apostles are teaching in Jerusalem. And they would draw the people away after themselves. But the problem is they would draw them from the wonderful grace of God that Paul was teaching that set men free. And they would bring them back under the bondage of the law. They would bring people into a legal relationship with God, which is never as exciting or free as a loving relationship with God. And so they would do havoc to the work that Paul had started. And wherever Paul would go, these fellows would just wait in the wings until he was gone, and then they would move in, and they would then try to draw after themselves those converts that had come to Christ through Paul's message of God's love and the grace of God. They would not go out to the world to reach the lost, but they would come in and try to siphon off from those that Paul had brought to Jesus Christ. Paul said that he did not build on another man's foundation, but there are always those that do seek to build on another man's foundation. And so Paul did warn, be careful how you build on that foundation. It is interesting, our security guards here in the parking lot are always having to apprehend people who come onto the parking lot and start putting flyers advertising other churches on your automobiles. They find them and they order them off the property, and then they remove the flyers that have been put on your windshields. We will usually then call the pastor of the church and suggest that maybe they should send the people down to the beach or other places in order to pass out their flyers. We can't quite understand why they would want to pass them out on our parking lot, in that the people are already coming to church here. And whenever we have something special, we don't come to their parking lots on Sunday morning to pass out the flyers, but we send them down to the beach, and the cars parked along the beach and so forth. We don't seek to call the righteous but sinners to repentance. The body of Christ really doesn't grow by shuffling people around from one church to another. The body of Christ grows by us going out to the lost and winning the lost for Jesus Christ. But there are always those who don't really go after the lost. That's too difficult. But they seek to go after those that have come to Jesus Christ. And so this is what Paul was concerned about there in Ephesus. Knowing the practice of these false prophets, knowing that as soon as he would leave a place, they would move in, try to siphon off the converts, try to draw men after themselves. Paul is now again warning these men, be on guard, protect the flock from these wolves that would only come and prey upon the flock of God. Throughout history, there have always been false prophets. And no doubt, until Jesus comes again, there will be false prophets. In the Old Testament, there were a lot of things that were said by the true prophets of God, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel. They had some very heavy words for the false shepherds, for the false prophets. Jesus himself had heavy words for the false prophets. Paul, Peter, they also had heavy words and warnings against false prophets. And you can be sure that there are many false prophets today. And again, as Peter said, they will use feigned words to make merchandise of you. When we were over in New Guinea several years ago, ministering there at a missions conference for the Wycliffe ministers, one of the fellows took us down to Goroka, a very beautiful town in the highlands of New Guinea, perfect year-round weather, and just beautiful, beautiful area. Beautiful area to live. And he showed us one of the large, lovely homes in the town, and he told us that that belonged to a certain, he called him, paper missionary. And I said, "What do you mean, paper missionary?" He said, "Well, he really doesn't have any mission work here, but he has quite a mailing, extensive mailing list of believers in the States, and he sends out his monthly missionary letter. He'll go out to the villages in his pickup truck, and he'll have a pickup, he'll have candy and all in the back of the truck, and he'll start tossing out the candy, and the kids all come running, hands reaching up for the candy," and he said he snaps the pictures of them. And then he writes home to the people and tells of their work of passing out New Testament to the children in the villages and how eager they are to receive, you know, the gospel. And, you know, he needs funds to build this church and all. And he has nothing out there, but just he lives off of the monies that are sent. He's a paper missionary, only on paper. Can you imagine? Well, how can a person do that, you say? The only way they can do it, that is they have no fear of God in their hearts. Can you imagine when that person has to stand before the Lord? What he's going to answer, what he's going to say? How can you respond to the Lord when, you know, when you do something like that? The whole issue comes down to the lack of the fear of God within a person's heart. If you have a genuine fear of the Lord, a realization that one day we're all going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ to receive from Him the rewards for the things that we've done while we were in these bodies. And Paul said, "Knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we seek to persuade men." So Paul is telling the elders now, "I know this. After I depart, grievous wolves will enter in among you, not sparing the flock. Also of your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things to draw away disciples after themselves. Therefore, watch and remember, because for 3 years I cease not to warn every one of you night and day with tears." It's something that we have to watch for. They exist, they're there, and be careful. When a person tells you that God's on the way to the poorhouse, don't believe them. That God is broke. That God's going to have to stop His work because He can't support it. And God is depending on you. The day God depends on you, He's in big trouble. We depend on Him. And He is faithful, and He'll never fail. Father, we ask that you will help us to be on guard against those, Lord, who would seek to prey upon your people, your flock. Lord, we realize that it's not really a comfortable subject when we have to expose the tactics of the false prophets. But Lord, it's so important that we not be gullible and just be taken in, but that we watch and are careful. Lord, we thank you for those true ministers who give themselves, the true shepherds, who will stand, Lord, when the tough times come to protect the flock. Thank you, Lord, for those that are giving themselves. And Lord, we pray that you'll expose the hirelings and protect your sheep. In Jesus' name. Amen. Shall we stand? The pastors are down here at the front to minister to you tonight. Whatever need you might have, we would encourage you to bring your needs before the Lord. They're here to pray with you. Two or three agree together, God will do it. So they're here to agree with you in this prayer of agreement that God will work in your behalf and take care of the needs that you might have tonight. Whatever type need it might be, God is surely able to help and to minister to you tonight. Sing alleluia to the Lord. Sing alleluia to the Lord. Sing alleluia. Sing alleluia. Sing alleluia to the Lord. Sing alleluia to the Lord.
Sing alleluia to the Lord.
Sing alleluia to the Lord.
Alleluia.
Sing alleluia. Sing alleluia. Sing alleluia to the Lord.
And now, on behalf of the Word for Today, the broadcast ministry of Pastor Chuck Smith, we thank you for joining us in today's broadcast. For more of Pastor Chuck's studies and biblical teaching resources, visit our website at pastorchuck.org. You can contact The Word for Today at The Word for Today, P.O. Box 890-820, Temecula, California, 92589. Or email us at infopastorchuck@gmail.com. We'll return with more of our verse-by-verse Bible study in our next broadcast with Pastor Chuck.